It is 7 o'clock in the Netherlands from the And the Groove Remains production team studios. My name is Mixmaster G and welcome to today's stream. It's a stream about Ask Me Anything, collection management and conversion for DJs, and I do this every Tuesday. So if you just want to join in or hop in, come on over. First things first, I've got some questions prepared for today's AMA, and I have of course the chat open and Yvette is monitoring the chat. If you got questions or if things are not clear that I explain, and I can imagine that, then please ask them in the chat and I will come back on that. Furthermore, each week I give away a set of the famous And the Groove Remains production team cup coasters, and they come in all kinds of shapes and shapes. They are packed in these nice packages, that's how they come. See that? And we had the winner of last week, DJ Syme, and I think he is from the UK. He made a very nice comment under the previous stream's video that he enjoyed it, basically. And if you enjoy this stream, or if you have new questions you want me to go into for the next stream, then please leave your questions under the comment section and I come back to it. And of course, you're automatically a contender for the famous ATGR cup coasters. What I'm gonna do? I'm going to do, first of all, I'm going to do again the ID3 tags for audio files, because to some guys this still is a mystery, and I understand why, because this can be very confusing. After that, I will go into the thing which Denon Prime users know very well, and that is if you've got your collection managed by iTunes, for instance, and you change the tags of your tracks, those changes don't make it over. I'm going to explain to you why that happens and how you can avoid it. Then I've got some other things about the Rekordbox Q and Key tool. Rek is basically also a tagging tool, and that means that it is perfect in line with the previous things. I'm going to show you some cool tricks with it, and I made a new version which will be available after this broadcast. And this new version has a new feature. So let's start with ID3 tags. And all I can tell you about ID3 tags is very simple. ID3 tags is the mechanism where information about an audio track is stored inside the media file, which means if you've got the MP3 file, if you've got the AFF file, if you've got whatever file, you've got the tags, and tags in this regard are artist, album, label, etc. Now there are two things at work here. First of all, there is what is called a common tags standard, and common tags are tags which are standardized, like indeed artist, artwork, label, album. But there are also very common tags we all use every day, which are not standardized and which are not stored inside the track files. And for instance, those are star ratings, but those are also the cues and loops. And those are play counts or import date. All that particular information is always stored in the collection database of whatever program you're using, because there is no tagging mechanism for it. Now, what have some guys like Serato or Traktor done? They developed their own tagging mechanism. And that tagging mechanism allows you to store that information without you knowing it inside the track file. But that is not standard. And it basically comes down to, if you store Serato cues inside an audio file, those Serato cues will only be available to a program that can read Serato cues, so Serato for instance. But Virtual DJ also reads Serato cues, so it can use those very same Serato cues. Traktor of course cannot, and Rekordbox cannot either. Those programs require the DJ Converse utility to make the Serato text into readable text for them. But the takeaway from this is, we have common ID3 tags, and those are standardized, and we have other ID3 tags which are not standardized, and you need to know if your particular tag is standardized or not, or otherwise you are changing stuff and you are only changing it for the software you are in. And that is why I always advise stay in iTunes for all your basic ID3 tagging, because iTunes can be read from basically any DJ software. So if you make your tags in iTunes, they can be read in Rekordbox, in Serato, etc. So that's why I say that. Now let's go into that and let me show you how different programs use different tags, because they all work very differently and it's important that you know how this stuff works. So up to the big screen. Here we are. And let me fire up my iTunes. And what I'm going to do is just make a very simple collection. This is of course my iPhone, which we don't need. We make a new playlist and we call it the Tuesday test, because today is Tuesday, May the 12th. And we put some audio tracks in it. And for this, oh, I got some there. And let's, if I change the folder name, I change the file path, which makes sure that if I use those tracks in the rest of this demo, that is never used. So those are unique paths, making all those tracks unique in my collection. Let's go for the acapellas first. And here we've got a couple of acapellas. Some will recognize it like, hey, Mixmaster G, you're always using the same acapella. Well, that's correct, because it's basically the same test stuff. Okay, we've got some tracks here, and you can see that iTunes found some information about those tracks inside the track tags. Those were red when I started up iTunes, and that is why the name and the title are there, but also why the genre is there, why the album is there, or why the track or the artwork is there, because iTunes read that the moment I imported those tracks. Now if I quit iTunes, and you remember that is important, quitting iTunes, because that's the only point where the iTunes XML is created, and that is where that is used by other software. And we go, for instance, let's fire up Rekordbox, why not? And you can see that I'm still living in Rekordbox 5.6.0. I had several questions about, hey Mixmaster G, where can I find Rekordbox 5.6.0, because the links are dead on the Rekordbox site. That is correct. Piny DJ moved those tracks to a new server and they didn't update all the links. If you need the current links to Rekordbox 5.6.0, pick one of my Rekordbox XML videos in the YouTube channel, and in the remarks you will find the correct download links, because I corrected it in all those videos. But back to Rekordbox 5.6.0. Let's head into the preferences, and there we go into the advanced part. And we can see that the iTunes library is loaded there, and that's exactly what I want. I'm going to enable syncing of all iTunes playlists, and that in a sense means that if I look right here, you see the Tuesday's test there, and you see that all the information is there. Now if I'm creating a new playlist right here, create a new playlist, and we call it test from iTunes. And bear with me, folks, because you will see why I'm doing this. And I'm doing this on the spot. I'm not preparing this, because then you understand what can go wrong with this kind of stuff. All right, here we have everything. Now, you saw me enabling the Sync Manager in iTunes. And that's basically the trick if you are using iTunes in Rekordbox. Why? Because each time you start up Rekordbox, Rekordbox will check the information in iTunes and synchronize it with its collection. And the collection of iTunes is not the same as the collection of Rekordbox, even if they contain the same tracks. So that's something you need to keep in mind. I quit Rekordbox, I go back to iTunes, and I'm just going to change some tags, first of all, right in here. Let me pull another one into the mix. I'm going to go with Engine Prime directly, because that's where all the questions were from Mixmaster G. How can we change our tags in iTunes? And you will see that it has some bugs, and those bugs will become very apparent the moment we are going inside this demonstration. So here is Engine. And there we have in the repertoire, there we have the Tuesday list, and I'm just importing it into a crate. Why not import as crate? And now if you go inside the crate, those tracks are not analyzed yet, and you can see they have basically all the information identical to how it is in iTunes. Let's analyze those tracks just for good measures. And that's done, I quit Engine Prime. All right, now if I change something in iTunes, for instance, we have the Ed Sheeran track Shape of You, and let's say that...
Love isn't the best place to find the lovers of the...
Thank you, Ed. We call it the Tuesday album. So what I do is I change within iTunes the album of Shape of You, and we can even say Ed Sheeran without music. So I did change two tags for the track of Ed Sheeran, Shape of You. Quit iTunes again, start a bracket box. We close that one out. And notice that without doing anything, the Shape of You is Shape of You without music. And if we ask for the album with it, I'm not sure if I have the album on right here, but we can always, of course, edit tracks with the editor. And there you see, it's the test album. Hold on, I'm looking at the wrong track there. We need the Shape of You track. And that is right here. And there you see, it's indeed the Tuesday album. So everything I changed in iTunes made it over to Rekordbox, which is exactly what we wanted. Now I'm going to our friends Engine Prime. And we go to the iTunes part and we update the library. And then we updated the library. And let's find Ed Sheeran here. You see that is updated correctly. Then I'm going to import the playlist, and we go to the crate, the playlist, and we find the Ed Sheeran track again. And there you see that the information is not updated. So the information is correct in the Tuesday crate, but if you look in the crate on the top level, then you see that it's no longer correct. And I see that even here, there we are. And let me find the Ed Sheeran track again. There we are. And now it's not correct there either. So let's update it again. And now you see it's again Ed Sheeran without music. I can even go to the crate. I can delete the crate, remove it completely. Go there. Import it again as a crate. Go there. And hold on, find my Ed Sheeran track, there we are again. And you see it's still the old tag. So it's coming back, you see it with the album as well, it's coming back to the same old track again. While in the iTunes part, let me update it again, you see that everything is correct. The only way I can fix this is by removing the track from my collection. Now the moment I do that, I also lose the analysis data of Engine Prime, and I lose my cues and loops. Let me show you how that should work, how that could work. So we have a Shape of You, and let me find it right here. And you see those are the old tags, and let's just give it a random cue. Then load a different track. I have to remove this particular track from my collection. Remove from the collection. That is done. Have to go to the iTunes list. Remove the crate just for safe measures, otherwise it won't even allow me to import the crate. Import as a crate. Go back to... I know it's a lot of work, isn't it? And you can see it still refuses to take it. So somehow it is even stuck with its own problem there. Because it should show. And you understand this is, it's even wrong here now. Update library again. And let me find the Etchion. Now it's correct again. Etchion without music on the Tuesday album. You understand this is not workable. Lucky for us, the things I changed, album and artist, are common tracks or common tags, which means that even if it doesn't allow me to change them, and now they are correct again. And now it says Ed Sheeran artist in the list there, but not there. This can be confusing as hell. Then you need to work this, or you need to fix this. All right. However, we can reload the tags. And reload tags, let's see, where is that thing? Re-import track information, reload tags, means that the program will pull the information from the audio file and use it again. And then you see indeed that the information becomes correct. So this is what we want to use. You cannot use it with importing from iTunes. You saw what a struggle that was, and I couldn't even make it working with the tracks removed from the main collection, which is ridiculous. We lost our cue in the process. But with a reload tags, you can get stuff done. Now, you must understand artwork is, for instance, also a common tag, which means that if I go back to iTunes and we find the Ed Sheeran track because we like it so much, and we are going to put some different artwork in it. Let me take that one out. And I hope that my default logos are there. They are, yeah, they are. So I just put the ATGR logo on the shape of you. Now, usually you could fix this with, you have always make sure that you have a different track inside the crate. And let me also change, besides the Ed Sheeran without music, we change that to no music. So I changed the artist tag again. This is important because I want to show you that indeed we get new tag information, but not all the tag information. Because if I say re-import track information, you see indeed Ed Sheeran with no music. But if I load it up, it even took the correct thing. All right, well, now this time it worked around. So it even took the picture of it, which is what we're supposed to do. But I know situations where it refused to take the image file, to update the image file. So keep that in mind. Now the big problem, that is the non-standardized tags, the things you cannot simply do with the, hold on, always have to load a different track in the deck for this to work. The things you cannot do with a re-import track information, and those are, for instance, star ratings, or those are play counts, or those are import dates. Those will not work because they need to come from the original collection. And as we have seen, that doesn't work. Let me show you how that not work. We give Ed Sheeran 2 stars. I quit Engine Prime. I go to iTunes. Or now let me show you it in Rekordbox as well. That is fun. Out. And let's see, do I have, yep, no, I don't have the ratings there. Let's see what we have for the rest of it. We go to the iTunes part. We sync it up, and then it should take the ratings there. It's still not taking the ratings. It is Tuesday, folks, so we have to see what's going on there. Are no ratings there. Let me double check that. Oh, I didn't quit iTunes. Lesson number one, always quit iTunes before you do other stuff, because otherwise your changes won't make it over. Let me double check that indeed we gave it 2 stars. There are no stars with shape of you, but now it got 2 stars. Double check, quit iTunes. Start Rekordbox. And show the shape of you tracks. Let's see where we are. Ed Sheeran, there we are, and you see it already got two tracks. There was nothing I needed to do because at startup, Rekordbox checks the active link, the active sync link with iTunes. It sees it got two stars and it takes them. Now let's go to Denon Prime because, like I told you, that doesn't work because star ratings are not a standardized tag. So first of all, let's go to iTunes. Let's find the Ed Sheeran track. There it is, and you see it has two stars as we want it to have. Let's remove this one from the list and let's import it again as a crate. Find the Ed Sheeran track. And indeed, it got two stars. It looks like this is working better now than it used to do. But let's see what happens if we go further with it. So let's double check that, like this. And we find the Ed Sheeran track. And indeed, it got our two stars. All right, now we go to iTunes and we give it four stars. Why not? We like the track. There we are. And then we go to Rekordbox. And then we look at the Shape of You track. Let me put that like this. There we are. And you see it got four stars as we want it to have. We go to Engine Prime. We go to the Tuesday test and you see that the Shape of You still got two. Thing is there, let's update the library. Now it got four as we want it to be to have. In our normal library it still got two. If I try this, I can't do it, so I have to remove this one and then most likely, folks, the trick is that you have to remove the original crate before it will replace it with the new one. So let's double check that. Let's update the library again. There we are. Import as a crate. And now it is stuck with two stars. All right, are you with me? Can you still follow this? So when you come from zero, there is no information there. It can go to two, but after that, you cannot change it. So only a change from zero to something else it will take, but if you change it from two to four, it will not take that information. Let me remove the track from the collection. Let me remove the crate from the collection. Of course, this is not a workable solution, but for my own peace of mind, I want to know what's going on. So let's see what's happening here. And then it makes it. So you have to delete the track from the collection in order for changes to occur. This particular thing is of course bugging as something because it's not workable. You cannot work like this. My tools don't have this problem. In my tools you can change as much as you can, as you like. And later on I most likely will show this, how this works with my tools and how you can do it with my tools. Basically, it works the same as in Rekordbox. Everything is taken care of. You don't have to think about it. Now, I did this example with iTunes, and I did this example with with Rekordbox and with Engine Prime. Engine Prime because it has troubles with how it with syncing it, but Engine Prime has the same problems with Serato, Rekordbox, etc. It's basically a design mistake. Once a track is in the Engine Prime collection, you cannot give it any new tagging information unless that tagging information is in the common tags, which are artist, album, label, etc. But if it's a non-common tags, cues, loops, beat grid, artwork, star ratings, then you have a problem. So keep that in mind. Those problems are there in Engine Prime and you have to work around it. Then finally, if you change your stuff outside, the program. So we still got this folder here. I had the a cappella folder, and let me batch change something inside that a cappella folder, and I use MediaRage for it. MediaRage is a tag editor, and it's basically the reason why I'm still on Mojave, because it's 32 bits and it's no longer available. So that's a little bit of a problem for me. What I do is in the a cappella, remember those are in iTunes, I'm going to change the album tag to "this is the album." So basically all tracks in it should have "this is the album." Then I go inside iTunes, and then you will encounter a problem that I have talked about before. Namely, iTunes is not real time. If iTunes is started, it doesn't check the tracks for changes in the track. So we still see there the old album. Only the moment we play a track, then you see it change. Or if we edit some of its other data, then you see it change. And of course, I have this very handy script that comes with the Rekordbox Q&K tool and with the Traktor Q&K tool. Refresh selected tags, and that will automatically take care of it. I will do that later, because there is no reload tags inside iTunes. However, Engine Prime has that reload tags, and so have Rekordbox. So let me show that to you in effect. Here we have the album, and if I say re-import track information, you see that indeed it shows you the correct information. Let me do it with a little batch there. You see, it is already automatically imported. So that is very convenient. Then you don't have to mess with it. The same with Rekordbox. Rekordbox also has a reload tag. Serato doesn't have a reload tag. However, Serato checks each and every track at startup. That is why Serato takes close to forever to start up, because it's checking all the tracks it has in its collection. The same with Traktor. Traktor also checks all the tags of the tracks before it starts fully up. So any changes you make externally will automatically make it to those programs. Our collection within Rekordbox was of course synced with iTunes. iTunes didn't update as we saw, but you have the reload tags right here. And if we just go to the editing part, we take, then you see that the album is indeed, this is the album. Now, for the convenience of us, it's easier just to do everything in iTunes again. And you need that script to refresh the text, to reload the text. Let me hit that, refresh select the text, and there you see it all changed automatically on a dime. I think the commands were changed as well. Yeah, because there are all test command field one. So that's fine for us. If I fire a bracket box again, it will sync it automatically. Hold on, I have to quit iTunes. I even fall for that. If you don't quit iTunes, you don't get the new information, because it's still the old XML. That XML is only updated if you quit iTunes. And it's easy to fall for that mistake, isn't it? Okay, and if we now look at, let's take some, then you see that everything there is changed for the test from iTunes list, of course, because there were some other tracks there as well. You can see all the albums are changed, the comment field should be changed, everything should basically be changed the way we set it. So this is very important, folks. iTunes doesn't update real time. You need to do it yourself. Once you update it real time, or updated it, and you have the sync manager taking care of the iTunes link in Rekordbox, that information automatically makes it over to your Rekordbox collection without any work. Engine Prime is a completely different proposition, because once a track is inside the collection and the tags used are not common tags, are not stored inside the ID3 tags of the media file, you cannot reload them. They are basically stuck. And as I said, my tools take care of that. Let me show that to you. Let me just show you how that works, because we can do that very quickly. I'm going to basically erase the existing RecordBox or the existing Ancient Prime library like that. I start up the Denon conversion utility. I'm not going to an external drive this time. I'm not going to do collection backup tool, etc. We basically go with the Denon conversion utility and see how that works. I select the iTunes XML, that is the file that was just created. And let's see, that is in my music in the iTunes. And then we've got the iTunes XML, that's it. I switch off the override because I want data to be overwritten, because that's the whole idea. We want to change stuff in iTunes and then change it automatically in our NGM Prime collection without any work, without deleting tracks or removing crates, etc. We just want it to work. So let's just do it like that. That was it. And you can see already that the tracks are there. And if we go to the Ed Sheeran track, we see that it has 4 stars, and you see that everything is there. Now let me quit iTunes, let me change something in or quit Engine Prime and change something in our friend iTunes again. Get the ratings on. There we are. Let's give it some default ratings. And let's give Ed Sheeran 1 star, which is not possible if you remember using iTunes, because it doesn't allow you to change it. And let's give it, do I have my original artwork? No, we don't have it. Let's give it to Martin Garrix and Dua Lipa. Art, why not? So I changed the ATGR art to that one. So I changed the artwork of Ed Sheeran. I changed it back to 1 star, and I gave some other stars away because we can. I quit Engine Prime, or I quit iTunes, which is important, as I just told you. Start up the Denon conversion utility again. Select the iTunes XML, which was just refreshed because I quit it. iTunes. Take off the protection, very important, folks. Otherwise, this would work like iTunes did, or like Engine Prime by default does. And we want the changes to show, so you need to take the protection off. And this was it. Let me make this a little bit wider, like this. And if we now find the Ed Sheeran track, where is it? There it is. There you see that it got the artwork from Martin Garrix, actually, and it has 1 star. So basically everything is real-time changed. This, of course, is a lot easier than having to delete crates, add crates, especially if you have very complex, very big collections. Then this is your only way to have changes inside Engine Prime if you edit them externally without reloading tags and without doing anything. Everything is taken care of automatically. Then, after the tag, let's ask, are there any questions? There are no questions at the moment, which means we can move on, and that will mean that I'm going to show you some new functionality and some really cool tricks with the RecordBox Q and Key tool. For those who are not familiar with it, the RecordBox Q and Key tool is a tool that enables a close integration of RecordBox with Mixed in Key. And you can, for instance, get the cues from Mixed in Key inside RecordBox without deleting your own cues. So they are added to it. And there are tons and tons of other things it does. But I'm going to show this for the folks who already use the RecordBox Q and Key tool, because there are some very important changes just made this afternoon to it. So I'm doubting, I make a new Pioneer, a new record box collection, just to make things easy. So let me delete that one and let me set up the empty record box collection, which is set up right there. Let me delete that so we know what we are doing. Basically just a couple of tracks randomly chosen, and I don't need playing one. I'm going to set all the keys to none, and I'm going to clear out all the comment fields. So there are basically no comments and no other data there. Let's take a focus track. Let's take the air track because it's on top of it. These tracks are not analyzed yet. Only the air track has been analyzed right now because I loaded it. And let's give it a cue. And you will see in a moment why I do it like this. So basically I've got a couple of tracks in record box. I haven't done anything with mixed in key yet, I just had them. However, what is important is those tracks have not been analyzed. What I'm going to do is I'm going to analyze a bunch of them. Just a random bunch of them. Select them in the collection view and say analyze tracks. And I want the BPM and grid. Now this grid, folks, is very important because the beat marker of the grid, the first beat in the grid, is used by the record box cue and key tool as an anchor to set the mixed in key cues. So if that grid is not available, or if that grid is not making any sense because the analysis of record box wasn't that good, then the cues from mixed in key will not make any sense. In previous versions of the record box cue and key tool, it just took the position as zero and set the mixed in key cues anyway, which didn't make any sense. In the new version of the record box cue and key tool, REC will refuse to set mixed in key cues if a track is not analyzed, and instead it will collect all those tracks that were not analyzed to a dedicated playlist, so they are very easy to batch analyze altogether, and that will make you the results of the REC mixed in key integration much better, because now it forces you to have a grid with each track, and that makes the results better. So it's a little bit pain, but a lot of gain by the quality, because the quality will improve so much. So that's why I did it like that. I'm going to export this as a Recordbox XML, which is always standard procedure for the Recordbox cue and key tool, and the reason why we cannot use Recordbox 6, because Recordbox 6 is lacking this particular export. I fire up the Recordbox cue and key tool right there. And I'm just going to set it to work without thinking. This is all automatic now. I didn't set any settings at all. And mind you, those tracks are most likely not inside mixed in key, because they were not analyzed yet, so they will not have a cue at all. Now if I go and take a look inside the playlists, you will find two playlists that are interesting. First of all, the No Grid playlist, and if you look at the full name, you see No Grid, analyzing in Recordbox and export the collection to XML, and that's exactly what needs to be done. These are the tracks that were not analyzed. In total 28 tracks. If you look at the collection size is in. The collection size is 36. We did have a few that I analyzed, and 28 were not analyzed. So what I need to do is import this playlist inside Recordbox. Why do I need to import it? Because I cannot analyze from here. You see, there's no analyzation there. However, if I take it in the playlists, then I can analyze tracks, and we want the BPM and grid. So basically, REC will collect all those tracks that have no grid, and put them in a dedicated playlist. You import that playlist inside your Rekordbox collection, analyze it, and after that we have to export it to XML again, because otherwise those changes are unknown to Rek. So that's very important, folks. Not only analyze it, but also export the collection to XML. Let me do that straight ahead. Then we have the To Be Keyed playlist. The To Be Keyed playlist is always a big mystery to people. What is that to be? The To Be Keyed playlist is basically tracks that were not inside the Mixing Key database, or at least that Rek couldn't find. If your tracks have non-ASCII characters, then those tracks cannot be found either. However, most of the time, if you have straight ASCII file paths, the To Be Keyed means that tracks need to be analyzed. So you fire up Mixing Key, and you basically just dump all the tracks from the To Be Keyed inside Mixing Key, and we wait for it to analyze. And after that analyzation, we quit Mixing Key, and if we fire up Rek, you will see that not only will the No Grid playlist be empty, it will even be missing from the Rekordbox XML. The To Be Keyed playlist, same story, it will be missing from the playlist overview in the XML, because everything has been keyed and be found in Mixed in Key. So let that give a little bit of time. There we are. I quit it. I did save the XML already, so I can go to Rek and let it do its magic. Again, I'm not going to mess with any settings. I'm just going to, with the default settings, and move on with it. Always fun that this is real time, folks. This is actually working real time, as you can see. And if we now look at the Rekordbox XML, you only see two playlists, namely the process tracks and the one with the merged queues. And you can see that the command fields are there. If you take a track now, you will see the purple Rek queues are there, and everything is there because everything could be found and could be analyzed. Now, another question I often get is Mixmaster G. I've got 100k of tracks inside my Rekordbox collection. Do I have Rek to process them all? No, you don't, because there is a range to, we can limit the scope of Rek. We can limit it to what it needs to be processed. And for that, let's add some new tracks to my Rekordbox collection. And I go to the, and let's take the Mixmash demo tracks for this one. And let me put them in a dedicated playlist so I know what I'm doing. They don't need to be in a playlist, but this is just for ease of use, because then I can say, all right, set the command to none and set the key to none. I do that because this will also reset the command and the key inside the ID3 tags of the file. Remember, there it is again, those ID3 tags. And otherwise, Rek will pick them up and already start creating the command field from a key that it can find inside the metadata of the track file. I don't want it. I want it to have everything from a Mixed in Key, which is why I reset it all, just to make sure that the information is going to get from Mixed in Key. I export this to XML. Remember, if you add tracks to Rekordbox, like I just did, you need to export to XML. Mind you, I did not analyze them yet. So that means that No Grid playlist will return. But I do that on purpose so you get a hang of how this all works. I quit Rekordbox. I fire up Rek again. And here comes the trick, folks. Of course, this is a very small Rekordbox collection. It now got 60 tracks or something, so it will process reasonably fast. However, if this is a 100k collection, then you want to use the analysis range tool. And in blue, you see that the previous range was from 1 through 36. Now, this isn't rocket science. You don't need to be precise with it. What I want is basically to start at track 36, because after track 36 are the new tracks. But just subtract a little bit, just for good measure. So let's say we take 32 and we leave the true field blank, which means it will go to the end of the list. So basically, we limit the scope. If this is my entire record box collection, only this part, the new part, will be processed by REC. And that will speed things up tremendously, because less work to do means less time to waste. So that's what you want to do if you add tracks to REC. You want to limit that scope. But we are not through, because remember, we did not analyze those tracks and we didn't dump them inside mixing key. So basically, that means that REC had no idea what to do with it other than to put them in dedicated playlists. And here are the dedicated playlists again. We import this playlist inside the Recordbox collection. There we have the new ones, and select them all and say analyze. Mind you that most of you guys will have the auto analysis on in the preferences of Recordbox, which is fine. This is just a safeguard that will catch any tracks that were not analyzed, because auto analysis, you can quit. If you quit Recordbox, auto analysis stops. If you forget to export to an XML, it's nice that you did auto analysis, but if you didn't save it, well, it's not there, so it cannot be used. So that is why that safeguard is there. It's there for a reason, basically. That has been analyzed. Let's start up Mixing Key. Because the tracks in To Be Keyed need also be part of the Mixing Key database, which you do it like this again. And you just wait for Mixing Key to end this. Mind you that I can already export the Recordbox XML. Remember, important that you export it again. We analyze the tracks, it needs to be exported, because otherwise it will not work. Mixing key is working in the back. You can see it counting down at the bottom of the window. So just give it some time. And that's almost there, as you can see. Quit mixing key, fire up the Recordbox queuing key tool. And this is important, folks. I need to set that advanced setting again, but it remembered for me what the setting was. So I basically just enter 32 there and let it go. There would be no harm if I didn't do this, if I just left it blank and it did analyze the entire Recordbox collection. The only thing would be that it would take longer, because every track would be analyzed instead of just the new tracks. So that's why that range is important. It's a time saver. It's not that it can cause troubles. It's just a time saver. And again, you can see the To Be Keyed playlist has disappeared from the XML. The No Grid playlist has disappeared from the XML, which means we are good. And we can just import the processed playlist. And if we go inside the mix mesh, you see that all the purple cues are there as we want them to be. So the takeaway from this is Recordbox queuing key tool now forces you and will remember you when tracks were not analyzed. And it does so because we want to offer you the best results and not just a random result, which was the previous version. So that's what's happening here. I'm going to ask if there are any questions. We don't have any questions left. That means that I'm going to conclude this live stream for this week. Next week, I'm going to show how you can use the collection backup tool and the Denon conversion utility together to create a Recordbox drive and an iTunes drive, which is basically the same drive and connected to a Denon player. And that's not something that is new, but what most of you don't realize is that same Denon drive can be used in other collections. You can go to your buddy DJs, take that Denon drive with you, connect it to their computer, and you can access your playlists from iTunes and all your data from Recordbox at will. And if you use iTunes with it, you can even get your virtual DJ playlist. You can even Get your Serato playlist all through that iTunes integration. And the real fun part is, this doesn't only work for Mac OS computers, you can even do that on a Windows computer. So that Denon drive is not just a Denon drive, basically it's your complete collection made portable, and that all on the same single drive. I go into the details of that next week. If you've got questions, leave them in the comment field. If you want to have a chance to win one of those ATGR cup coasters, leave a nice comment and maybe you will be the one that will be picked to receive a final coaster. We send them worldwide. It doesn't matter where you live. We just ship them to you and hope that the postal service will get it over to you. For now, thank you for watching. Don't forget to like and subscribe. Mixmaster G signing off. Doe je dat nou? Not yet. Ik zeg nee. Pas als hij stopt met praten.